JFT, just fair and direct.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to JFD's daily market review for April the 28th. I am Charalambos, senior market analyst here at JFD, and I will talk about yesterday's main market movers, what's my opinion moving ahead, what are today's important events, and how they could affect the markets. But before we start, let's read our disclaimer. The content we produce does not constitute investment advice or investment recommendation, should not be considered as such, and does not in any way constitute an invitation to acquire any financial instrument or product. I will leave you a few seconds to read the rest, and then we will jump into our analysis. Okay, the dollar traded slightly higher against the majority of the other G10 currencies on Monday and during the Asian morning Tuesday. It gained notably only against the Kiwi, while it underperformed versus NOK. The greenback was found virtually unchanged against the Canadian dollar and the Japanese yen. Although not clear by the performance in the FX sphere, market sentiment was supported yesterday, and we can realize that if we turn our gaze to the equity world. Here, all major EU and US indices closed in positive territory, with the positive morale rolling somewhat into the Asian session today. Although Japan's Nikkei and China's Shanghai composite slid 0.20 and 0.07% respectively, Hong Kong's Hang Seng and South Korea's KOSPI gained 0.94 and 0.39%. Now, EU shares were led by airline stocks on hopes that Germany's and France's governments will provide aid packages in support of the Lufthansa and Air France companies, respectively. DAX was the main gainer, perhaps receiving additional support by Deutsche Bank's better-than-expected earnings for the first quarter, while Italy's FTSE MIB took the second place after the S&P Global Agency left Italy's credit rating unchanged, easing concerns over a potential junk rating. Later in the day, Wall Street may have been boosted by optimism surrounding the coronavirus saga, as several US states began relaxing some of the stay-at-home restrictive measures. Now, as for our view, we will not get too excited, and we will stick to our guns that taking things day by day is the best approach. Lifting measures too soon and too quickly just to prevent further economic fallout may prove to be a disaster, as it risks another wave of exponential spreading of the virus. In our view, it has to be a very slow procedure, which, although will delay any potential rebound in economic activity, the recovery may be much more concrete. Now back to the currencies. The Kiwi came under strong selling pressure overnight after Westpac said it expects the RBNZ to cut interest rates to -0.5% in November, a move that could be telegraphed as early as in August. The bank also expects officials to double their QE program to 60 billion Kiwis in May. But for now, Kiwi traders may turn their attention to New Zealand's employment data for the first quarter due out during the Asian morning Wednesday. The unemployment rate is forecast to have increased to 4.2% from 4%, while the net change in employment is expected to have accelerated to 0.3% quarter over quarter from 0.2%. In our view, acceleration in new jobs combined with a rise in the unemployment rate may be a good thing, as it could mean more unemployed people getting encouraged to register and start actively looking for a job. Thus, on top of the accelerating inflation for the quarter, a decent employment report may result in second thoughts over the RBNZ's future course of action. Now, apart from New Zealand's jobs data, tonight we also get Australia's CPIs for the first quarter. The headline rate is expected to have risen from 1.8% year over year to 2%, which is the lower bound of the RBA's target range. That said, the trimmed mean and weighted mean rates are expected to have remained decently lower. The trimmed mean one is forecast to have held steady at 1.6% year over year, while the weighted one is forecast to have increased to 1.5% from 1.3%. When they last met, Australian policymakers left monetary policy unchanged and offered some details with regards to their QE program. They noted that they will do what is necessary to achieve a three-year yield target of 0.25%, with the target expected to remain in place until progress is being made towards the goals for full employment and inflation. However, they added that if conditions continue to improve, it is likely that smaller and less frequent purchases of government bonds will be required. Now, after saying that interest rates have reached their effective lower bound at their previous meeting, the aforementioned points suggest that there is very little chance of expanding their QE program. On the contrary, they could soon scale it back if the spreading of the coronavirus continues to level off. Thus, slightly better inflation numbers are unlikely to make them change their minds. We believe that in order for that to happen, the spreading of the pandemic may have to get out of control again. Now, passing the ball to central banks, following the Bank of Japan's decision to expand its stimulus efforts in order to combat the economic fallout from the coronavirus pandemic, today the central bank torch will be passed to the Riksbank. On the 16th and 19th of March, the world's oldest central bank decided to extend its bond purchases this year by up to 300 billion SEK in order to mitigate the effects of the pandemic, while on March the 26th, officials decided to initiate purchases of commercial paper issued by Swedish non-financial corporations. It appears that Swedish policymakers do not want to cut rates back into negative waters, and that's why they are expanding their purchases. Since then, inflation data showed that both the headline CPI and CPIF rates declined to 0.6% year over year from 1%, while the core CPIF1, which excludes energy, ticked down to 1.5% from 1.6%. Given that the slide in the core CPIF rate was not as big as in the headline prints, we can confidently say that the headline declines were mostly due to the tumble in oil prices. This may allow officials to wait for a while more before deciding whether additional measures are needed, as they may prefer to wait and see whether the already adopted measures are having the desired effects. Now, as for the rest of today's events, the only releases worth mentioning besides the Riksbank decision is the US Conference Board Consumer Sentiment Index for April, which is forecast to have declined to 87.9 from 120, and the American Petroleum Institute weekly report on crude oil inventories, for which no forecast is available. As for tonight, during the Asia Morning Wednesday, apart from New Zealand's employment report and Australia's CPIs, we also get New Zealand's trade balance for March. So that's it from me. Thank you very much for watching and listening. For those who are interested in learning about the main events of the week much earlier, you can subscribe to the weekly Market Outlook webinar, which I'm holding every Monday at 7 o'clock a.m. GMT time. So goodbye, have a great day, and I'm looking forward to seeing you here again tomorrow.
JFT, just fair and direct.